I remember when my wife became pregnant with our first child and thinking to myself, I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses me with a daughter so that I can name her after my mother, rahmatullah alayha, May. Many times people ask me why I named my daughter May. It was the name of my mother, rahmatullah alayha. And I remember, subhanAllah, making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah blesses me with a daughter. And then finally, you know, going to the doctor and seeing on that ultrasound that it was indeed a girl. And I was so happy, bursting with joy, ready to tell everyone that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with a daughter. Unfortunately, the reaction that I got was not exactly the one that I was expecting. Many people responded with du'as in Arabic, رَبْنَ يَعْوَدْلَكَ وَلَدْ رَبْنَ يَعْطِيكَ السُّبْيَانِ. May Allah replace that one with a boy. Hopefully you'll get lucky the next time and Allah will give you a boy. And I thought to myself, wow, we still live in a culture like this. And unfortunately, the fact of the matter is, until now, people fail to cherish and recognize the blessing of a daughter. And if we look at the time that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, you know, you have to understand that not only were the Arabs of Jahiliyyah vicious towards their daughters, and not only did they, you know, not consider their daughters to be a blessing, but in fact they considered them to be a curse. But actually this was the culture for years and years before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all around the world. In fact, you'll find that this was the case in, we would obviously assume, you know, Southeast Asia and things of that sort. But even in biblical scripture, in Ecclesiasticus, in the Catholic Bible, the Catholic Church had to deal with this verse where it says the birth of a daughter is a loss. So it was always considered that way. And here you have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming, and one of the first verses that's revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam amongst the society of people that bury their daughters alive was وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When the young girl that was buried alive will ask, for what reason was will be asked, for what reason were you killed? She will testify in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against her murderer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala condemned the behavior of the Arabs when they would take their young girls and they would bury them alive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described to us their attitude, the way that they used to view their daughters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nahl, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى. Whenever one of them is given the bushra, the blessing, the glad tiding of a young girl, you would see that their faces, وُجُوهُمْ مُسْوَدَّ. You would find that their faces are darkened. وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ. And why that, and that person is full of grief on the inside. يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ. They are embarrassed. They're trying to hide their faces from the people because of the bad news that they received. And they're struggling within themselves whether they should bury their daughters, or whether they should live in humiliation, or they should bury their daughters to fulfill the tradition. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. What a terrible judgment that they make in that regard. And I want you to think about this for a moment. You know, these were human beings that were bringing themselves to do that. And some of them, you know, they struggled with this. You might have heard the story of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu burying his daughter alive in Jahiliyyah. But in fact, that's not an authentic narration. It's a fabricated narration, because Umar radiallahu anhu had four daughters and he was actually named Abu Hafsa. Abu Hafsa, whenever Islam came. But we do have people, Sahaba, that came to the Prophet ﷺ and confessed to the Prophet ﷺ that they were indeed guilty of this grievous practice. Amongst them was Qais, who came to the Prophet ﷺ, Qais ibn Asim, and told him that I buried many daughters before Islam. You know, what should I do? And you know, some of the scholars here comment that this is the one thing that the Prophet ﷺ legislated, an expiation. Although it was not made mandatory, although it was not sent down as an obligation, but the Prophet ﷺ said that a person should do something to expiate for something that they did in Jahiliyyah. The Prophet ﷺ told him, you should free a slave for each and every single person, each and every single one of those daughters that you killed. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, all I have is camels. I own a bunch of camels. So the Prophet ﷺ said, then free a camel. Donate a camel for each one of those daughters that you killed. You know, and some of the scholars said that's the only time the Prophet ﷺ did that. There is even a more explicit narration in Sunan Ad-Darimi, where a man came to the Prophet ﷺ and told the Prophet ﷺ about this terrible incident that took place in his own life, where he says that, you know, when my daughter was born, I loved her, I fell in love with her, she loved me. And, you know, I used to call her name and she used to come running to me, and she was growing up and she was getting more and more beautiful, and I didn't know what to do with her, because he had an attachment to her. The human being, the mawadda, the fitra that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in that person to love his daughter, it was there. right? You know, he said, I was attached to her and she was attached to me. I used to come home and play with her. But as she was getting older, I didn't know what to do with myself. You know, everyone was burying their daughters. And here I am, and I still haven't buried my daughter. So one day he says that I told her, I told her to pick out a pretty dress, and I told her that we were going to a celebration at her uncle's house. And on the way there, he said to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I pushed her into a well, and she grabbed on and she called out to me. Imagine this daughter calling out to her father, "Oh my father, you know, why are you doing this to me? Why are you leaving me?" And he said that, you know, I'd be overcome with emotion at one moment, and I'd start to pick her up, and then, you know, the shaitan would get the best of me. You see, he was fighting his fitrah, the natural emotion, compassion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put inside of him. He was fighting that, and he said, I'd let her go back in. And she called me and she said, don't break the trust that was given to you. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was crying and weeping so heavily when this man was talking, that the Prophet ﷺ's beard became soaked, and the Prophet ﷺ was choked with tears. He didn't even know what to say. And Rasulullah ﷺ said to him, he said, you know, if I could punish anyone for something that they did in jahiliyyah, in ignorance, I would punish you. But Allah has forgiven everyone for what they've done in ignorance, so turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. So this barbaric mentality, which, by the way, even in our modern days, you know, in our, we'll see honor killings, we'll see people kill their daughters, we'll see, we had the recent story in India where the father stuffed his daughter's mouth with sawdust until she died. Terrible stories. In China with the one child policy, you know, because couples could only have one child until now, by the way, you know, if it turned out to be a daughter, they would hope that she would die, and they'd actually start to take steps to make sure that she dies so that the first child and their only child would be a son. We hear about this all the time, but we forget that in our deen, this ignorance was lifted. Not only that, but the Prophet ﷺ taught us to cherish our daughters. We should be pleased when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us with daughters. And we should do our best to fulfill that amana to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know, there's a funny incident that took place where a man came to Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, and he told Imam Ahmad, he said, you know, ya Imam, you know, my wife only gives birth to girls. They didn't understand science very well back then. So my wife only gives birth to daughters. And he said, I have three daughters. What do I do? And Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he said, Abshir, you should be happy. Congratulations. You are the closest one to the sunnah, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only survived by daughters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't allow any of the boys of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to live a long life. Okay, so this is like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually has stated that there is more virtue in having daughters than sons. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in Sahih Muslim, a very beautiful and profound hadith, he said, man rabba tiflatain, whoever raises two daughters, wa ahsana tarbiyatahuma, and he's great, and you know, he does his best to raise them right, you know, to give them compassion, to show them care, to show them love, to show them loyalty, and to teach them the proper way. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that he will be with me, كَانَ صَاحِبِي يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ كَهَاتَيْنِ, he will be with me on the day of judgment like these two fingers. Just like this, the same reward that the Prophet ﷺ said is guaranteed for the one who takes care of the orphan. He'll be with me like this in Jannah. And in another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever takes care of three daughters and is patient with them and shows mercy towards them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow them to protect him, to shield him from the hellfire. And some of the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, what about two daughters? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and two. And one of the Sahaba said, and Ya Rasulullah, what about one daughter? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and one. Right? So here we see a preference that's given to showing our, you know, to raising our daughters properly. And we have to understand, Allah knows what He gave us. Right? And we look in Surah Ali Imran, the mother of Maryam alayhi salam, radiallahu anha, when she called Hinna bintu Faqud, when she called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and she dedicated the child in her stomach for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she was sure it was going to be a boy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَتْ رَبِّي إِنِّي وَضَعْتُهَا أُنْثَى. She said, oh Allah, I gave birth to a girl. And Allah breaks away from the story and tells us, وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا وَضَعَتْ. Allah knows what He gave her. So instead of her just having a prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have just gave her Isa alayhi salam. Allah put in her lineage the best woman that ever existed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her through that woman Isa alayhi salam, and she still gets the reward for that. Right? So why not think in that manner that, you know, maybe I can have the greatest, you know, amongst the greatest women, I can raise this daughter to be amongst the greatest women. And maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give me through that woman many more children, right? That will carry on that legacy and that will continue to provide me good deeds. Also, we find from the Prophet ﷺ that not only did he praise, you know, having a daughter, and not only did he show us that we should be grateful when we have a daughter, but the Prophet ﷺ treated his daughters with such love and compassion. When Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha would walk into the room, the Prophet ﷺ would leave his seat, and he would give Fatima radiallahu anha the place, the space that he was sitting in. In his last moments, Rasulullah ﷺ calls Fatima radiallahu anha and whispers into her ear, giving her the news that he's going to die, and then giving her the news that she would be the first one to join him in al-Jannah. Right? This love and compassion. Umama radiallahu anha. In al-Bukhari, it's narrated that the Prophet ﷺ was once praying, and he was holding Umama while he was praying, and whenever he would go down, he would place her on the ground, and then when he'd come back up, he'd pick her back up and he'd hold her in salah. Giving us legislation, by the way, tashri', showing us that it's permissible to do so. And we find even with someone like Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, one of my favorite narrations, you know, because it shows you the human side of the Sahaba. Al-Bara' radiallahu anhu narrates in al-Bukhari that one time Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu walked in, and Aisha radiallahu anha, while she was still a young girl under his care, was laying there and she was sick. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he sat down next to her and he kissed her on the cheek and he said, "Kayfa haluki? How are you, oh my dear daughter? How are you, oh my dear daughter?" You know, kissing her on the cheek, showing compassion to her. SubhanAllah, this is the way that the Sahaba treated their daughters. This is the way the Prophet ﷺ taught us to treat our daughters. And it's unfortunate that even in our civilized communities, in our civilized societies, so-called civilized societies, we still have this backwards mentality that a daughter is loss. We should not think that way. And you'll find even in very wealthy households, you know, "I'm going to send my son to be a alim. I'm going to teach him the Quran. Hopefully my son will be a hafiz. If I have a daughter, you know, hopefully she knows Qul Huwallahu Ahad, inshallah we'll be alright then. You know, we did our job." No! Why do we have such a lack of female scholarship in our community? It's because of the failure of parents, and also at the same time, the lack of gratefulness and gratitude that we have to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by not fulfilling the amana of treating our daughters well and raising them on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be great women like Maryam, like Khadija, like Aisha, like Fatima, like Asiya, like Hajar, and hoping that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shield us from the hellfire as a result of that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a people that cherish our daughters, that raise them with good tarbiyah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those whose daughters will protect them from the hellfire and enter them into Jannah along with our families in the companionship of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the highest level of Jannah, al-Firdaus. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khayran. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.